5, Chapter 231, adequate notice of this regular meeting of the Board of Adjustments of the Township of Franklin has been provided. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Betterbit?
Yeah.
Ms. Grauman? Mr. Johnson? Mr. McCracken? Mr. Rich?
Here.
Mr. Shepherd?
I'm here.
Mr. Caldwell? Mr. Rosenthal?
Here.
Mr. Reese?
Yes.
Ms. McGow?
Here.
Chairman Thomas?
Here. Okay, minutes, regular meeting, December 17th, 2015. We have a motion.
Moved.
Second.
Mr. Rich?
Four.
Mr. Rosenthal?
Yes.
Mr. Reese?
Yes.
McGow?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. Minutes, February 4th, regular meeting.
I move.
2016.
I'll move.
Second.
Mr. Betterbit?
Yes.
Mr. Rosenthal?
Yes.
Ms. McGow?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. Resolutions.
Now, I better tell you.
Coincidentally.
You're doing Montauk first, right?
Yes.
Mr. Betterbit, Mr. Rosenthal, Ms. McGow, and Chairman Thomas can vote.
Okay, this is ZBA 16-00001, Montauk. We have a motion to approve.
Move.
Second.
Mr. Betterbit?
Yes.
Ms. Rosenthal?
Yes.
McGow?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. DeSapio?
Same four.
ZBA 15-00028, we need a motion.
Move.
Second.
Mr. Betterbit?
Yes.
Ms. Rosenthal?
Yes.
Ms. McGow?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. And then the NYSMSA LP, ZBA 15-00026.
Mr. Shepherd, Mr. Rosenthal, Ms. McGow, and Chairman Thomas can vote.
Cell towers. We need a motion.
Yep.
Moved.
Second.
Mr. Shepherd?
Yes.
Rosenthal?
Yes.
McGow?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. Resolutions, April retainer, 865. We need a motion.
Moved, and I would say that that we get good value from Mr.
Bradshaw.
Bradshaw, thank you.
it's still going to be 865. We still need a second after
second.
That eloquent. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed, and then we have the Washneck Resolution, 19250.
No. Nope. We have a.
Okay.
I think Frank has the extension of time, right? Frank, do you have Cam?
Yeah.
Is that you? Cam's. Is that the extension of time you have tonight?
No, it's Linus.
Cam Development Corp.
Linus.
Who's that?
Lanford. He sent a letter.
Oh. Oh, okay. I thought I confused between the two of you.
Have we done it with just a letter in the past?
Well, it's up to you. You can, or you can make them come back. It's completely up to you.
We haven't done it with a letter. Yeah.
This Cam. Yeah, this is what we're doing now. This is a letter.
He's asking for this to be scheduled?
He's asking for a year extension because he's been unable to perfect bulk variance approvals from a resolution adopted November 6, 2014, expiring June 30th. So you have time to bring him in if you want. Before it expires, is he scheduled for any new ones?
I would say let him come in. He's coming here in the beginning of May. I would rather have him come and explain it.
All right. And I guess
he's here for like 3-4 matters. The first meeting in May, so
we can table it.
Yeah.
Okay. The hearing for the evening, Tabachnik Fine Foods Incorporated, ZBA 15-00018. Site plan with variances in which the applicant's proposing an addition at 1230 Hamilton Street, Block 92, lots 5 through 48, in the R10 zone.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Adjustment. My name is Francis P. Linus. My offices are located here in Somerset, New Jersey. We're happy to be here tonight. I'm pleased to represent Tabachnik Fine Foods, Inc. This indeed is a use variance application to construct a 31,188-square-foot expansion of Tabachnik's existing food processing facility. We're also seeking preliminary and final site plan approval and other variance relief. This property, if you know it, is located at 1230 Hamilton Street. Just by way of further location, it intersects with Wheeler Place and is within the R10 residential zoning district. It also fronts on Coddington Avenue. It's a 2.84-acre site, currently developed with the Tabachnik's 28,220-square-foot food processing business. They process soups, and the soups are great. Tabachnik received the use variance and site plan approval from this board way back in 1997, and at that time, the board approved an expansion of its then non-conforming manufacturing use, and they received a number of variances at that time for lot coverage and impervious coverage. In 2007, the westerly portion of the site that is before you was the subject of a use variance and site plan approval for Anthony's Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling, Inc., and the board granted approval to Anthony's to construct a two-story office and warehouse plumbing, heating, and cooling facility. Variances were also granted for Anthony's use with respect to lot coverage and impervious coverage. That approval was not constructed, and Tabachnik subsequently purchased the adjoining property for the sole and express purpose of seeking an expansion of its food processing facility on the property. Now, our witnesses this evening, I have Rita Tabachnik. Rita is a principal in the company and president of Tabachnik's, and the widow of the late Ben Tabachnik, who until his death in November of 2014 was instrumental in operating Tabachnik's Fine Foods at this location in Somerset. In the 1990s, Tabachnik moved the soup business to 1230 Hamilton Street. Rita's going to provide you with the history of Tabachnik's, and she's going to bring it up to the present day. And she'll testify as to why we're here, what the need is for the expansion, and she'll also testify regarding the operations of Tabachnik's both now and in the future. We will then present Oliver Wilhelm of Seibel Wilhelm Architects, Tabachnik's licensed architect. He prepared the architectural plans for this application, and you'll see what we are actually proposing. Our third witness will be Mitch Ardman from the Reynolds Group. He's the applicant's civil engineer. He prepared the site plan and the engineering documents in support of the application. Very briefly, we have Doug Poliniak of Dolan and Dean. They prepared the traffic impact statement for this application. And then finally, we have Kevin O'Brien. He's our client's licensed professional planner, and he's going to provide you with the planning testimony in support of the use and other variances that are being requested. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Rita Tabachnik and perhaps have her sworn in.
Sure. And make sure the mic's working for us, too. So.
Hello.
Okay. If you raise your right hand for me, solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay. And your name for the record?
Rita Tabachnik.
All right.
Okay, Rita, what's your relationship to Tabachnik Fine Foods, Inc.?
I am the president of Tabachnik Fine Foods. I oversee all of the daily operations, and I operate the company.
Okay. And Mr. Dominak made reference to the fact that you brought an army with you. They may not testify, but do you want to introduce them for board?
I'd like to. I have my COO, Robert Ingebretson, who's my right hand. I have my two sons, Jason Tabachnik and Alexander Tabachnik. They're my legacies. Jason will be passing out our handout that I'd like you to have in front of you. My daughters couldn't be here, but my daughter Anna is representative because she did the slideshow. She's a communications major.
All right, we did indeed have a slideshow prepared for the board, and I see that your son is handing out the packets.
You want me to mark those?
Yes, Exhibit A1.
Okay.
Will be that series of slides that they'll be shown on the board.
Thanks. Do you want me to begin to speak about the exhibit?
All right, Rita, again, you brought with you a slideshow that we've marked as Exhibit A1. You want to go through the slide for the board?
Yes. Alex, you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This obviously is our name, Tabashik Fine Foods. Taquino Lum, that means repair the world, make it a better place than you found it. This is our history. My husband's family came over in the 1900s, and they founded a delicatessen chain. They made all the normal pastrami, smoked fish. They went from there. They made soups that were very, very popular. They were so popular that they began to freeze them. And from the freezing operation, we then began to sell them to supermarkets in the 1970s. And that's when my husband became involved in the business. He had gone to Rider University, had a degree in accounting, had a background in food science, and he was very instrumental in the formulations of most of the products. Alex, next slide, please. Oh, you skip. Go back, honey. Oh, you're too quick? There we go. All right. Okay. So here we are. These are examples of our soups, the soup singles, and the line on the right-hand side is the Benji line. I came out with that about 6 months ago. That's the memorial line that I set up for my husband. It's organic, all natural. These products are made right here in Somerset in my 1230 Hamilton facility. As you can see, we moved in the 1990s. And in 2004, I was fortunate you allowed me to put a freezer on because we were expanding sales. Basically, the soup company is national, selling in all major markets. And every year I look to expand and sell more soups. And thankfully, I've been very, I wouldn't want to say very successful, but I've been very fortunate. And thankfully, the people here in Somerset have been very cooperative. And it's been a positive experience dealing with, you know, the board and with any applications that I've had to make. Oh, yeah, that's right, 2007. Well, in 2007, unfortunately, I was not able to put my peanut butter facility into this facility. It's just too small. And since they make peanuts in Georgia, I opened up a facility in Georgia, but it's a rental. I don't own it, and it's an older plant. Go ahead, Jeff. Okay. This is a picture of the people, the babies who actually use the product. It's known as ready-to-use therapeutic foods. Next one.
Is that the peanut butter?
This is the peanut butter that's used for all these different children. It comes in two different forms, the ready-to-use therapeutic foods and the ready-to-use supplemental foods based on younger children and then older children. And I'm seeking to expand the facility because the plant in Georgia really cannot produce the capacity that's necessary for these life-saving humanitarian.
All right, so the entire proposed addition is to house the peanut butter manufacturing.
That's
is that correct?
Yes, that's exactly right. I would like to bring home the facility to Georgia by building the plant here from Georgia to New Jersey.
And you're currently one of only three companies?
Oh, yeah, thanks, Frank. Yeah, actually, I am one of only three companies nationally who are certified to make this product by the USDA. And I think it would be in Somerset's, I wouldn't want to say best interest, but it certainly would be a spotlight on Somerset to have a humanitarian product like this manufactured in Somerset. I know there are a lot of local politicians who would love to come and tour the facility. I know I got a call from the Lieutenant Governor's office that she'd like to be there for the ribbon cutting. And I said, if I build it, I'll invite her, and hopefully I'll be able to convince the board that it's worthwhile.
Sorry.
Xander, did we skip something? Okay.
Experiencing technical difficulty?
No.
Well.
Yeah, that's a picture of one of the infants using my therapeutic food. Well, actually, my husband did all the formulations on these.
Next slide, please.
Okay, well, this is who I distribute to. USAID, USDA, UNICEF, and the World Food Program. And they're the three.
What's USAID? What is it?
USAID is the Food for Peace program that is operated out of Washington, D.C. Basically, 70% of all the food that's distributed globally is supplied by the United States, and it's primarily run out of the USAID program, which sends foods all over the world to whoever's in need. So your tax dollars spent wisely. Okay, this is a picture of my husband, and obviously, I'm very proud of him. He did the formulations for all of these products. He was a wonderful humanitarian. Actually, he's getting a humanitarian, he gets a humanitarian award every year from Holy Apostles Church in New York City. It's a soup kitchen, and he's been a sponsor for the last 30 years. But he really wanted to do something to help starving children, and that was one of his main motivations for coming up with the peanut butter. And we also hope, obviously, to bring some jobs to Franklin, and he stay here in Somerset, and I don't have to go back to Georgia all the time, which would be good for me. Xander, we keep seeing the lion, honey.
What is this?
Okay. And basically, this is where I'm hoping that you'll consider allowing me to build this facility, and who it helps, and why you should let me build, because I think it'd be worthwhile for Franklin, worthwhile for Somerset. Obviously, globally, it will help because it's a wonderful product. As I said, there's only three other people in the United States qualified and certified to make it. Okay. So I'm fortunate in that respect because my husband gave me a great business. It's a legacy business. I have, as I said, my two sons and my two daughters in it, and I'd like to continue, and I'd like to continue right here in Franklin. I really hope to move my facility up from Georgia.
All right, Rita, let's discuss operations. Can you tell the board and any members of the public who are here your current operation at Tabachnik Fine Foods? Number of employees. How many employees do you currently have?
I currently have between 31 and 35 employees. The extra numbers are salespeople who aren't normally in the facility. They live in multiple states.
Okay. And what are your hours of operation?
The cooks come in at 1 o'clock in the morning, and they stay till 9. And then the shift starts with the regular manufacturing at 7, runs till 3 for the manufacturing plant, and then office employees stay till 5.
And they've been doing that since the late 90s?
Since the late 90s, that's
okay.
Correct.
All right. How's parking at the site currently?
And you don't see that changing?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't. I think that's basically how it's going to be.
All right, good.
How's the parking on the site?
Well, there's really not a problem with parking at all because we have a lot of local people who work for us, and they walk to work. 20% live locally. And as I said, my four children, you know, work for me, live with me, and we all drive in the same car. But we also have a lot of legacies. I have a lot of, like, my CFO's son works for us. They come in the same car. We have a lot of people who carpool, and a lot of our employees, because they live locally, also carpool. So I don't really foresee any difficulty with cars or parking.
All right. And what type of delivery vehicles frequent the site, and how frequently do they deliver it, and what times of day do they deliver?
They deliver primarily between 7 and 3. The trucks come in. Currently in the soup plant, we normally have about 6 trucks during the course of the day, but they're not all tractor trailers. Some of them are small because some of them are ingredients, some of them are produce. They're not all tractor trailers.
Okay. All right, how about the expansion? You are expanding, and I take it the expansion is solely and exclusively for the separate peanut butter operation. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. I expect to have 4 to 5 trucks a day delivering for the peanut butter.
Okay. And additional employees?
Yes, I'm going to have 19 additional employees. I'm going to be running 2 shifts. The first shift will have 9 employees, and the second shift will have 10.
Okay. Any
What are they delivering, just peanuts?
Oh, no. Peanuts, vitamin blend, oil, maltodextrin.
All right.
All ingredients for the food product,
butter.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, and you don't expect any change in the hours of deliveries, right?
No, I don't.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Or the hours of operation, basically.
No.
Okay.
No.
All right. Now, did you have an opportunity to review with me and our team the staff reports that were generated as a result of this application?
Yes, I did.
Okay. One comment from the Township Engineer's report indicates that when you received an approval back in 1997, there were certain punch list items that needed to be fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
Are you agreeing tonight to make sure that those punch list items are fulfilled?
Yes, I am.
All right, you had one little question, though, and one little minor concern, and that would be with the curbing. You want to discuss that issue briefly?
Yes, I have beautiful shade trees on that side that every, my employees, I have picnic benches under there. They like to eat under the trees. I'm hoping I'm able to keep the trees, but if you want me to take them down to put the curbing in, I'm willing to do that.
Okay. Now, Mr. Healy, the township manager.
That would be on the Wheeler side?
I think that's where it is. Isn't it on the curb?
Yeah. Frank, is your engineer going to speak to whether the trees, whether the curbing can be put without the trees coming down? And
yes.
Okay.
Well, he's going to speak to the issue of curbing.
Thank you.
Again, this is a request from Mr. Bachnick. Mm-hmm. All right. Did you get a chance to review with us the Mark Healy's memorandum dated March 15, 2016?
Yes.
Okay. And you do acknowledge that if approved, your development will be subject to the payment of affordable housing development fees?
Yes.
All right. Okay.
Able.
All right. Now, in your own words, why is this expansion important to Tabachnik, Franklin Township, and the world?
Well, it's very important because, first of all, I'm in a rental down in Georgia. I can't make the capacity at USAID. I was called down to USAID about a month and a half ago, where they told me they expect to have, because of El Nino, a famine. And when there's going to be a famine, we're going to have malnutrition. And they said, expect that after they have the famine, that they're going to have a flood. So they expect the need for this product to go up. And unfortunately, the plant in Georgia can only make 8,000 cases a week, and they need 10. So what they've said to me is, you know, how can you increase production? And the answer is, I can't. I'm already running the plant 6 days a week, and on the seventh day, we clean. Because the peanut butter, I wouldn't want to say it gums up the line, but you have to have a day to clean. So I'm running the plant 24 hours a day down there. Now, they have older equipment. As I said, it's not my plant. When I build up here, I'm going to be bringing in brand-new equipment. That's why I won't need as many people, and I won't have to run it three shifts, you know, a day. And I also won't have to run weekends. So in actuality, what will probably end up happening with the new equipment, I'll only have to run 4 days, and I'll be able to clean on the fifth day. So that'll be very, very productive.
And this will be state-of-the-art,
is
that correct?
And this will be state-of-the-art. Everything will be state-of-the-art. It'll be completely clean, self-contained. And the real reason to do this is there's tremendous global need. If you read the papers on any given day, there's malnutrition, there's starving children. And for me to bring this home to Franklin Township, I think would be a benefit to New Jersey. It's certainly a benefit globally, because the three people who primarily distribute to everyone who's malnourished and who needs food is USAID, and through the USDA program, UNICEF, and the World Food Program. The World Food Program basically is in Rome, and that's all the nations of the world. And they get together and say, you know, this is what we need. And what's happened is, since 2007, they've proved that this specific product, my peanut butter product, the ready-to-use therapeutic food and ready-to-use, isn't this terrible? I'm having a mind blank, a little blank here. Anyway, both of my peanut butter products are proven. And in the past, they've had a tremendous amount of problem with, like, wheat or grain or rice being delivered onto the docks, and they're rotting there, and they can't get through the warlords. I can honestly say that my product, they actually had to drop by plane, because it's in a box that's very, very sturdy and can be dropped out of the back of a military plane into the locations that it's needed. So in terms of this product, it's been proven to be helpful. It's actually, I've been told that this is going to be preferred to dropping off grain or rice or wheat on the docks.
All right, I have no further questions.
Okay. I have one question. With the increasing world need for this project, don't you envision eventually having to work more days or more shifts to meet the demand?
Well, I think what's going to happen is I have very, very efficient machinery. And what will end up happening is I can go to a third shift, you know, during the week.
So that's the point I'm making. You may have to work more shifts in order to meet the demand for stuff.
Well, what I can also do is I can just buy an extra machine and put it in and run the same hours with an extra machine. I don't have to. Right now, I only have one machine that can do two shifts. If I put in a second machine, I can actually run less hours because I'll have more machinery in the same location.
Yeah, I mean, in my working days.
Use the mic, Joel.
I was in the manufacturing business.
Right.
And in order to get oh, is it on? No. In order to get your ROI, I mean, I don't know too many manufacturing plants that don't take advantage of their facility and equipment and run more shifts, you know.
Right. Well, I'm gonna start out with just one machine. Yeah. And from what all of my technologists tell me, I should be able to produce the amount of cases. I am actually going to be able to produce during those two shifts more than 10,000 cases. I'm actually, with the new machinery, I'm actually going to be able to produce, I believe it's closer to 15,000 cases. So the problem with Georgia is it's old and the machinery is old. It's just like, you know, when you get a new cell phone or a new computer and it's hotter and faster and better, that's what my machinery is. It's a Ferrari as opposed to a Toyota.
State of the art.
State of the art.
Any other questions?
Just two questions, Mr. Chairman. One of the variances is for the placement of a refrigerator unit in what's the required front yard in the back on Coddington. Why is it being placed there?
We have our architect and engineer will address that, but you can certainly answer it.
You know, I honestly don't remember at this point.
Well, you
I don't like to defer to
it. Well, you didn't place it there, correct?
No, I didn't.
Okay.
Architect and engineer. Sounds like one of your other witnesses is going to answer that. And what about one of the things that we've heard, and from the planning and the zoning department over the years, and I don't know if it's a real thing or not, but we have heard comments from the residents of in the surrounding area about odor. Can you speak to that about, you know, I guess the expansions could be for the peanut butter?
Right.
Can you speak to what methods are going to be employed to make sure, you know?
Well, the building is very well insulated. And, you know, we're going to be producing the product. And I know from the plant in Georgia, which is old, that you can't smell the peanut butter outside. So I think that the way that it's designed, you're really not going to have a leakage smell coming out of the factory during the manufacturing hours.
Is there anything different between the manufacturer of soup versus peanut butter, too, that would affect that?
Well, there's a tremendous difference because, first of all, the peanut butter has to be handled. It's got to be temperature controlled. That's number one. And because of what the FDA requires, we have to heat it to a certain degree to make sure that we're meeting all the standards. Mm-hmm. And this actually, we do a lot of nutrient testing on this. So we're constantly pulling samples because that's what's required by, you know, USDA, you know, to meet the standard. Because this is for children who are severely malnourished.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't foresee that there's going to be any leakage of odor on this because it's so, it's heated quickly, it's packed quickly, it's cooled quickly. You put it into the, actually these are packages if you'd like to take a look at them. This is what the actual product looks like. Would you like to give you a few more?
But just generally, you're saying that the overall manufacturing process of peanut butter as opposed to soup would have a far less likely, odor.
Exactly, because it has to be heated quickly, brought down quickly, and packed quickly. Otherwise, you get oil separation.
Okay.
So the process on it is very, very fast.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Any other questions? Next witness.
Oliver Wilhelm.
Oh, I was really enjoying that, too.
I know you were. I know you
So this isn't going in a... You're not selling the syringes that I see in the pictures.
Oh,
you're
no.
just
well,
selling
that's,
the...
No, I'm selling the product. That's
right.
What they use to feed the babies when
right.
they're malnourished.
Right.
Yeah, no, I have no syringes.
Okay.
Gives you a chance.
Okay, sir, once you get seated, raise your right hand for me. Solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
And just spell your last name for the record.
Sure. W-I-L-H-E-L-M.
All right, Oliver Wilhelm, what's your background, qualifications, and experience?
I'm a licensed architect.
Hold the mic up.
I'm a licensed architect.
Right, close to your lips.
Close to my lips.
Like a rock star. There you go.
There you go.
You're all good.
Licensed in New Jersey, right?
I am licensed in New Jersey. I'm currently a partner in Seibel Wilhelm Architects for the last 20 years. We've been working with Pabachnik for, I don't know, I think we did the 2007 expansion. We've done the 2004 work, and we're currently doing...
We're okay with this.
Now, what's your firm's involvement with this application? Did you prepare the architectural plans and the exhibits that are before the board this evening?
We did.
Okay. Now, you brought with you certain exhibits, and I'd like you to go over to the board.
Sure.
And explain what the exhibits are. The first series of exhibits we do not need to mark. They were part of our submission, so he'll go rapidly through the exhibits.
Sure. What we were able to do with the remaining area footprint of the building that we did, we created a flow through raw ingredient, through processing, through packaging, and through storage, and back into loading dock to make a seamless transition from raw product to finished product and be able to get out the door. Location of loading docks, we'll discuss later with the civil engineer. With regards to turning radiuses and getting 18-wheelers in and out, and also staging before they sort of not in any way, shape, or form interrupting Hamilton, the main road. We do show a two-line situation. First line is the one that the patient is going to be using, and they also have the ability to have a second line in the facility. That's all underground floor level, and you'll see that there's a large warehouse, state of the art as well. All incoming product come in along the backside or the Cottington Avenue side, and it's 9 deep slide rack, and it's, I believe, 5 high, and basically it'll run, you'll pick here, you come in, and you take it out, all state of the art. On the second,
and what you were just referring to for the record was A1 that you,
yes,
of your plans, correct?
Of my plans.
Okay.
Yes.
You want to identify the next exhibit that is part of the submission?
That is correct. This is A2, which is the second floor, and unfortunately, that also requires office space. Since we didn't have enough room with everything on the first floor, we ended up doing a second floor. We didn't use the entire area, so you have a small roof deck over the top. However, the storage areas, we needed both levels to meet the requirements, both on raw product as well as unfinished product. And that's what you're going to see in a few minutes as far as the volume is concerned.
And the next sheet is A3 of the submission?
A3 is submission.
And what does that represent, Oliver?
These are the elevations of the new expansion, both from the street side or the west side, as well as a section through the new expansion. This is a section through the storage area, as well as an elevation of the loading docks as they are, and you'll see the windows for the offices above. And then this is a section, an elevation from Hamilton. This is the expansion. This is the office entranceway on the corner. Has Tabachnik on the street side. As far as signage is concerned, and this is a back storage area, and you'll see the loading docks. And then.
And now you're going to show A4, and you'll identify what A4 is, or you'd have A4. Are you skipping A4?
No, I won't. But I actually foreshadowed something I didn't want to foreshadow quite so soon. Okay. What you see here is the north and the south elevations. The south elevation is if I was standing on Cottington. Okay, and I think that was asked for by Mr. Healy. Okay, and what you're seeing right now, I'm sorry, you're seeing the existing building, and then you're also seeing the new expansion. It's a blank wall, okay? And then we have also the north elevation.
And is that the part that's 38 feet tall? No.
Yes.
It is?
Yes.
Okay.
Sir.
All right.
Okay. Now.
All right, you want to mark that if it hasn't been part of your submission? The next one.
What? They don't also have the south elevation, which is shown here.
All right.
So if you want to mark that.
All right, you want to mark that A2? Put today's dates.
I'm sorry?
A2.
A2. Yes, sir.
Put today's date on it, please.
Yes. Now.
All right, you want to identify and mark this exhibit?
Yep. A3?
A3, today's date.
Okay.
What is A3?
A3 is a three-dimensional or perspective from up high, indicating both the existing facility of, that Tabachnik has, as well as a new processing area for the peanut butter, as well as the courtyard area. And
that's Hamilton right there?
This is Hamilton in front, and this is Cottington behind.
Okay, and Wheel is to the left?
Wheel is to the left, yes.
Okay.
Okay, that's the orientation. And you'll see the car parking in front. We have a fenced-in area for the loading area, and this is the both the existing loading docks for Tabachnik, as well as the new ones for the peanut butter plant.
When you say it's fenced in, what does that mean? Does that mean there's a fence that runs all the way across?
It'll close up the loading docks in the evening
so
hours.
That they will not be, people can't mess
can't
around.
Can't get into it.
Okay.
That's correct.
All right.
And if there's a truck that comes prior to, we have enough room to stage that truck and not affect Hamilton.
So in other words, when you say stage the truck, do you mean park it outside of the gates?
Yes, because they wouldn't be allowed in.
Okay.
But how about the fire trucks?
How about fire trucks?
Yeah, just in case, over there.
There is some mechanism that we could have to allow fire trucks in an emergency situation.
And Mr. Aardman will testify with respect to the Fire Prevention Bureau's report and our ability to comply with the same.
Okay. All right.
All right, you want to mark the next exhibit and identify it?
The next exhibit is a rendering of the western elevation. What's that? What am I up to, A5?
Four.
Four.
I think it's A5.
I got the aerial photo 3D, and then I got...
I'm going to be coming to 5 in a moment.
This All right, what is A4?
A4 is a perspective of the new entranceway for the peanut butter area. It's a two-story glass in a closed small lobby with an elevator and a staircase going up to the second floor offices. You'll see some windows on here, and there's also a means of egress coming out of the backside of it. It's got car parking, which Mitchell attests to as far as zoning and car parking capacity. We worked very hard to get as many cars as we possibly could and still get the detention and everything else that we was needed for the approval. And we're also showing a small Tabachnik monument sign as well on the street side. And you can also see the amount of greenery that we've incorporated into this design to minimize in any way, shape, or form the perceived volume that this is actually, what this actually is. And now you see the interior of the loading dock area.
You want to mark that as well?
Yes, I will. This is just a blow-up of the loading dock area, and you'll see the second floor windows. This is a raw product storage area. Now, there was a question before with regards to the type of materials that we're using for the building. Our firm is heavy into food processing and food manufacturing and food distribution. And I can tell you the litany, you don't want to hear it. Insulated metal panel construction does two things for us. A, it now provides a material that is attractive on the exterior, provides the insulation properties necessary when it's 90 degrees outside and needing to be 65, whatever temperature you need inside, and it'll keep that temperature at the right level. It'll work. It's got high insulation and R value. It is also wash downable, both on the exterior and the interior. And so there why, that is the reason why we're using the insulator panel basically on the entire exterior of the building.
What are the, what is the surface of the panel made out of? Is it a porcelain or a?
No, it's a metal.
It's a metal.
Well, it's a Kynor metal, Kynor finish.
So it's unfinished?
No, it's Kynor. It can be painted any color you'd like.
Well, what color are you going to paint it?
We haven't decided that yet.
Well, this is your time to decide that, because this is also I think you have to tell us that.
Okay.
All right.
Tell them.
Okay. We're going to go to a beige color.
Okay. All right.
And it's going to be a nice beige.
All right. There's a site plan as well as, right, Francis? Right.
Excuse me? What was that, Bob?
It's a site plan hearing as well as...
That's exactly right. Correct. You're absolutely
100%
so correct.
Not tell me that. And
well, it's also a use variance, so you want the aesthetic issue right. resolved as well. Right. Yes.
Understood.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. Now, let's. There are a number of variances that I want you to testify to. The first one, variance request. The first one is building height. First of all, what does the zone allow?
38 feet.
No, the zone, what does the zone allow? 35, the zone allows 35 feet.
The zoning allows 35 feet.
Your building is at what height?
38 foot 6 currently.
Okay, and why do you need a variance?
Much of the machinery and lines associated with creating the peanut butter has a volume and a height requirement that put my second floor higher than I wanted to. Hence the reason why I had to go to 38.6.
All right. Now, Mr. Healy points out that the 38.6 tips the scale vis-a-vis a C variance and a D variance, since it's 10% or more would be a D variance, and that's exactly 10%. Is there any adjustment you could make to put it in the C category?
I will take 6 inches off the office ceiling side and be able to create that 38-foot height.
Okay.
Well, I don't know if the 6 inches really makes a difference. I think the real critical thing is, does it, going higher than permitted, is there a hardship that would result in terms of the operation of the building, the storage of the materials? If you comply 35 feet, how would that affect your building and affect your compliance?
I couldn't use the equipment that was necessary to create the peanut butter.
Okay, so whether it's 38 feet or 38 feet and 6 inches,
I needed the office space.
You need that
on
additional
top.
3 feet of height to
yes.
accommodate the materials,
absolutely.
And storage and the machinery that you have in the operation.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Okay, Oliver, we're also seeking a lot coverage variance, and Mitchell do the heavy lift on that. But from your perspective, why is a lot coverage variance necessary?
Because of the requirements of the manufacturing end of this thing, the storage end of it, and all the program that was required in order to manufacture this peanut butter in the quantities that were necessary.
Okay. And what about impervious coverage? And again, Mitch is going to be the heavy lifter on the impervious coverage request. But from your perspective.
Again, what we have here is a manufacturing building that's got a new use. It's got support requirements, and what we tried to do is maximize the remaining area for impervious, and just went as much as we possibly could.
All right, and then the final variance that I'm going to ask you to testify to has to do with the signage. We're proposing two signs. Mm-hmm. One sign is permitted. You want to explain to the board where the signs would be as proposed,
sure.
and what the signs would say?
This one would be...
All right, what are you referring
I'm sorry,
to?
I'm
exhibit
sorry, I'm what? Referring to the monument sign.
No. What exhibit are you referring to?
I'm sorry. Exhibit A4.
Okay, and the perspective of that exhibit, what are we looking at from? Hamilton Street?
Hamilton Street, and we're coming from the north going south or west? We're coming to west.
Okay. And the left side of the building is facing what?
Wheeler? Yes.
Okay. So where are our proposed signs going?
One will be going on the street side of the awning for the entranceway.
On Hamilton?
On Hamilton.
Okay.
So everybody sees it and understands it. And the second one would be the monument sign that is facing east-west on Hamilton. And I also had a second sign on the awning here. Yes.
Okay, one sign on the Wheeler side, is that what you're saying?
One, no. Hamilton side, mm-hmm. and one on the west side of the elevation.
And that's the variance. The variance is the two building signs.
Right.
Two building signs, yes.
Okay. And what are the two building signs going to say?
Tabachnik.
Okay. All right. Now, I also asked you to review the staff reports where it applies to your testimony, and I'm going to refer you and the board to Mark Healy's March 15th memorandum, specifically page 3, item 2. What he alluded to with Ms. Tabachnik is what is the justification for placement of the refrigerator units in the required front yard facing the unimproved portion of Cottington Avenue? Why are we locating the refrigeration units there?
It's the proximity of where they're required. It's as simple as that.
Say that again.
It's the proximity of where they are required.
In other words, the refrigeration units will only work if they're located within a certain distance of the box?
They'll be more effective when they're closer to the box that okay. they're. Right. In other words, the condenser and the evaporator work together.
Yeah.
If I'm sitting there with a long cable going to it, it's not worth it.
Right.
You understand.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any other location on the site that would work as efficiently and effectively as the proposed location?
Not as efficiently as effectively.
Okay. All right. Now, the signs, if the board approves the second sign and all the signs, will they be architecturally compatible and in scale with the building?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And that's noticeable, too.
Okay. I'm referring you and the board to page 4, item 3 of Mr. Healy's report. We discussed that before. That's the height issue. I'm referring you to item 4E. You have presented the color renderings to the board. Is that correct?
Is the board satisfied with the renderings that I provided?
Yes, they're very good.
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, elevation of the building. And you did provide an elevation of the south side of the building.
I was requested to,
right.
So I provided.
Okay, all right.
And it's the next witness that's going to talk about the curbs?
Yes.
Okay.
Mitch Hardman, yep. And then finally, item 4G, if necessary, you will conform the architectural plans with the site plan. Is that correct?
Yes, if there's anything wrong.
If there is, you'll conform
yeah,
it.
Absolutely.
I have no further questions.
Any board questions?
I just have a question, not associated with him, but on the package, Frank, maybe you could ask them, why does it say manufactured for Tabachnik Fine Foods? Why doesn't it say manufactured by?
Rita?
Use the mic just so it picks up on that.
Because I have a co-packer in Georgia. I don't own the facility,
right.
It's a rental. So the people in Georgia make the product for me, which is why I'd like to bring it home here so I can make it myself in Somerset County in Franklin. All I have is I have a rental space in somebody else's building, and they manufacture for me. That's why it says manufactured for Tabachnik instead of by.
Right.
Thank you for asking.
Okay.
You had a question.
Yeah. Is the freezer inside the building, or is it this box outside the building?
The freezer's inside.
Oh, okay. Okay, so the facade signs.
The box that's outside is actually the compressor that cools. Freezer.
Okay. But what Mark was talking about is inside the building.
I don't believe so.
No, the site plan has it says refrigerator units. Yeah, it's a separate
correct. Those are the
box
compressors.
Outside the building.
Oh.
That is correct.
Those are compressors, okay.
Those are compressors.
Okay, the signs, what is the awning made of? Is that metal or wood?
It'll be a metal.
Okay, and what is the lettering, the sign lettering? Is it painted? Is it channel set letters? illuminated?
No, it'll be painted. It'll be screened on to the metal.
Okay. And it'll say Tabachnik Fine Foods?
Absolutely.
On both sides?
Yes.
Okay. And will there be lighting to illuminate that?
Most likely, yes.
Okay.
Off the building.
All right. And is the monument sign illuminated?
It probably will be. Ground lit.
Okay. All right. Oh, what's the color of the existing building?
Beige.
All right. So the new addition is going to coordinate with that?
Without question.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Next witness.
All right. Mitch Hardman. Thank you, Oliver.
Thank you.
Thank you, Board.
Okay. Tell me, swear or affirm, tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
All right.
Mitchell Hardman, still licensed professional engineer, still the Reynolds Group, still current.
And still in New Jersey, right?
But still in New Jersey.
Okay.
You can move still on from that.
All right, Mitch, you prepared the site plan as well as the stormwater impact report and as well as the environmental impact statement that's part of the record in these proceedings. Is that correct, Mitchell?
That is correct.
All right. I think you brought an exhibit with you, and I guess we're up to A6?
Six.
You want to mark that A6 and identify it, please, Mitch?
A6 is our dimension plan, sheet 3, but it has been rendered and the landscaping has been superimposed on it as well.
All right. Briefly describe the site, existing conditions, and what's proposed.
What do you mean when you say rendered?
The color rendering we've added to the
plan. Oh, okay, all right.
Yeah. Some pretty colors. Okay. So we have, to orient everybody, Hamilton Street on the top, Wheeler Street on the right side, and Coddington at the bottom of the colored area, which is the bottom of the property. North is up on the plan. So as you heard described, the existing building is on the right side here, which is the brownish shaded color building. It goes up to this line that I'm pointing to today. So that's the total area of the existing building on the site. Presently, there's a driveway entrance off of Hamilton that is staying, and this is at the location I'm pointing at, and there's some parking also that exists in that front area, both to the right and the left of that existing entrance driveway. As far as the left side of the property where we show the proposed building, that's the area that has been purchased by Tabachnik recently, that Frank referred to, that a prior application was approved on. That's a vacant wooded site at the present time. And that's on the westerly side of the property. Once you combine those two, that gives us two areas. That's the 2.84 acres of the property. For the surrounding on Wheeler Place, you can see we have some residents here on the right side. And then in Coddington, the last house is really just at the corner. Coddington, the pavement right now dead ends where I'm showing you here on the plan, just a little ways west of that intersection of Wheeler. The rest of that is presently just a paper street in that area. The other closest residence is on the west side of the property that faces on Hamilton Street, as I pointed in that location. So that's pretty much the gist as far as existing conditions. As far as proposed, and you heard Oliver describe the addition, basically it's going to be this L-shaped addition that we're going to put onto the existing building. It's going to match up the westerly face of the building here, basically what will become the center. It'll be the same width, and it'll also be the same offset from Coddington as the existing building is. And as I said, that L shape will basically create this enclosure, this looped, or now we have a U enclosure here. And that's the courtyard that you saw in the three-dimensional renderings that Oliver showed you. That courtyard will actually, I believe, be a positive for the site plan and for the neighborhood for this site. The driveway will stay where it is, but basically it's going to enclose those parking, loading, and tractor-trailer functions. Right now, that area is basically open to the back to Coddington. Once that goes in, if the building provides its own buffer and screen, if you will, to the neighbors, to the residential neighbors. So you'll have the same trucks come in. This was the existing docks as described, and the new docks will come in here. But again, as I just said, they'll be screened from the neighborhood. There'll be three loading docks, an area for a dumpster, and a couple of extra parking stalls will be expanded to the west side. On the further west side of the building is where we're going to put the new driveway in off of Hamilton, 18 new parking spaces. Two of those will be ADA accessible, and the rendering of the new main entrance and glass tower portion is at this northwest corner of the building that I'm pointing at. So as you're driving east, that'll be the, you know, the classic shot. That's the new building. That's the new entrance that's going to show off this facility.
Okay, Mitch, are you done with your, all right. There are certain variances that are needed to have the board approve the application. What I want you to do is compare the variances previously granted to both sites.
Yep.
Okay, back in 1997, the original Tabachnik approval, and in 2007, the Anthony's Plumbing approval.
Certainly.
And, of course, relate them to M2 zone requirements because we're in an R10 zone.
Rightly. And I did actually was around then, and I prepared those plans that were approved by this board back in 97. So as I stated, the setback off
of... someone was around at that time, you know.
Off of Coddington, we're holding that same line, so that same setback variance will apply off of Coddington. And off of Hamilton as well, we've kept that same street line as you go forward. So that same street setback off of Hamilton will apply. And as was stated, we are in the R10 zone. If you see on our cover sheet here, we've done the zoning analysis. And we've shown what the R10 would be and also what the M2 would be. And for those setbacks, basically we show that we're holding off of the 25 feet is what we're holding for the new distance off of Hamilton.
But that exists for the current building,
correct? That exists. Actually, it's as close as 21 feet 2 inches on there. So we're... That's just one little corner. We're basically holding the same line, so it'll be 25. Off of Coddington, it's the 24.9 feet, where 25 feet is required, and we're holding that same 24 feet, 9 inches. Wheeler Place, we do meet the 25-foot setback in that location.
And 15 feet for the refrigeration units?
Right. And again, as was stated, that's really, as you can see, our site plan layout. If you move east-west, it would be the same setback requirement. Really, the only other spot would be to move it on the far side of the parking lot, and that wouldn't be efficient, as you heard Oliver describe the use of that. Also, again, we're past where there are any houses. What back up to it is a paper street in this location, so that's correct. It is a variance, but technically, since it's a paper street, and there are no residences anywhere in that area. As I said, the residence is a couple hundred feet to the east on the corner.
All right, I told the board you were going to do a heavy lift on the lot coverage variance, so help us out and do the heavy lift.
Wait, before you go there, let's talk a little bit more about the refrigeration unit. Is it simply that one little spot there at the corner of the building?
Yeah, this shaded... That box okay. That we have shaped.
And that there. And that changes the setback from 25 to 15?
Yeah, the building itself is basically 25.
Yeah.
And but that unit, that closest point of that unit is a little bit over 15.
Okay. It doesn't look that way. It looks like it's only 20, but so you scale that or?
Yeah, because we have to have some separation from the building, and when the pad is 6 to 8 feet wide, so you add those up. And
all right. How tall is it?
Neighborhood of 4 to 4.5 feet.
Okay.
So it's not a large volume.
Right.
It's a shed.
Right, and it's like, what, like 8 feet long? And
depending on the, yes, anywhere from 8 to 9 feet
long. Okay, all right. Does it make any noise? Yeah.
Can you give him the mic, please?
There are fans that blow off the top, like any other condenser
okay.
does.
All right.
But as we know, there is no residence in there.
I got that.
Regarding the lot coverage, as Frank brought up, so that's the building square footage. Again, as was described, part of what the square footage need for extra is really the separation here of these warehouses. When I first was involved and started sketching, I learned a lot of the peanut butter line, that more than I ever knew. You can't combine, we had hoped to, from my mind, reutilize some of that warehouse space. You can't. These products have to be separated. Rita described all the things about the processing, the separation, and basically clean space. So we couldn't double use the existing warehouse. So that was a need for to get its own warehouse space and its own function of shipping in and out that Oliver described, that whole picking unit and taking and sending. That's what's going to need square footage on the property to make this a viable project.
All right, and finally, the impervious coverage variance.
Right, so similar for impervious. Again, this is what's needed for this site and to make this work. The parking, again, is what's needed. There's a balance between getting enough parking for these employees, and we didn't want to shorten it any and then have people not finding spaces to park. So we figured this was an appropriate balance between getting sufficient parking and the loading area, which added up. And with those two things, that's where we came up with the impervious area.
All right. Did you have an opportunity to review the staff reports that we were furnished?
Yes, I did.
Okay. The first one would be the Township Engineer's April 5th, 2016 memorandum, one issued by Julio Vega.
Yes.
All right. Did you review that with our client?
I reviewed it with our client. I also had a chance to speak with Mr. Vega about that.
Okay. And what are your comments with respect to that memorandum?
We can comply with all his comments.
Okay. All the comments?
Yep.
Okay. And as a matter of fact, on stormwater management, you did indeed submit a stormwater management impact report under your signature dated 8/5/15, revised January 2016, and that's part of the record in these proceedings, aren't they?
Can you, yes, but that's part of the record, but I'd like him to talk about that a little bit because, of course, the big problem with the high amount of coverage here is that there's going to be stormwater runoff, and where's that going to go?
Yep. And that's what Frank was leading me on.
I understand that, but I want you to talk to that.
Chase. So we actually think it's going to be a benefit. So under existing conditions, there's the building, there's pavement, and it just sheet flows. There's an inlet, and it goes to Hamilton. There's no detention right now. From the wooded area, it basically, that mostly sheet flows west towards our neighbor. With this plan, we're going to have three components of the stormwater. They're going to be oversized underground pipes here, about 800 feet of 36-inch pipes. That's going to hold the water, slow it down before it gets out, piped out to Hamilton, controlled now. Under the western parking lot, similarly, we're going to have oversized pipes that's going to store the water and, again, slowly meter it out to Hamilton. And the third component we have is a bioretention basin. That bioretention basin is kind of the belt and suspenders for some additional storage of stormwater runoff. Three components, remember me saying we have to deal with volume and peak rates. We meet that, and the bioretention will also get us our water quality and our groundwater recharge. By doing these, any water that flowed to the west before towards those properties is now cut off and go to Hamilton controlled.
How is it getting from the surface to the underground pipes? We've got catch basins?
Yeah, so in this area, there's catch basins, and in this small area, actually, it's shallow. Some of it sheets right into the detention or retention basin. And DNR Canal has signed off on the stormwater report as well.
All right, before we leave Julio's report, curbing.
Curbing.
You heard Rita request that.
And
trees,
it's just, we wanted to bring it up as a minor. The short of it is, if we can work with staff, with Julio, with Mark, to look at the tree and look out here, and if there's a way to adjust a little bit to save the tree, we just wanted to be on the record that we might try and do that. If in the end the answer is curb it all the way down, we would. But there are some nice trees there that we would, maybe a piece of curb doesn't go in, maybe it's a little narrower, so we just wanted the board to be aware of that. But as long as we'll make sure staff is happy with whatever we come up with.
How do we put that in the resolution?
I'll take care of it.
Okay, good.
I got it.
All right, what's the status of the outside agency applications that have been filed?
They are all pending now as yours. We've made resubmissions, so soil erosion control, DNR Canal, the technical they signed off, they pen your approval. And the county also technical, they're satisfied.
All right, the other township departments, you reviewed the sewage authority report. You're okay with that,
that's
right?
Fine.
Fire department?
No problem.
Okay with that. Police department? Okay with that. And Somerset County Health Department, they're okay with us?
They're okay with us.
Okay. Now, we have Mr. Healy again, who had a March 15, 2016 memorandum. His item number four, site plan comments. What about possible relocation of the light pole and or sign?
Yeah, no problem. We'll adjust those two so there's no conflict there. Okay. The only thing I have to do for Mark is count a little better to make sure my tree replacement calculation is correct, and I will do that as well.
So is there anything in my report you can't comply with?
No, we're fine.
Okay.
Right. Thank you.
Good. All right. And there was an April 1st, 2016 comments of David Triggs of the Environmental Commission. For the record, you did submit an environmental impact statement.
Yes.
Okay. And you're making that part of the record in these proceedings, correct?
Correct. And I think same thing with the lighting as there is with that truck area. This building is going to serve to cut off any light spillage or anything to any of the surrounding neighbors. So we think it's a benefit with this layout.
And in support of Rita's request for trees, the Environmental Commission is concerned about loss of trees. Right. Okay. All right.
Can you say again what you said about the lighting?
So there's going to be lighting in this car and truck courtyard.
Okay.
There are presently lights there now that are potentially visible to the neighbors. Once that building's there, no way you're going to see them.
Okay. Are they going to be down-focused?
Yeah, they're LEDs. You'll get good light distribution. They're 22 feet high where the building is 30-plus, so
okay.
You won't
good.
See them behind you.
I'm assuming lights on the building on Coddington are just going to be limited to minor security lighting over doors or something? The architect seems to be raising his hand.
Yeah, we shouldn't have need for lighting on Coddington at all.
Thank you.
All right, just to quickly go through the rest of the Environmental Commission statement, you don't see any negligible increase of noise as a result of this, right?
No, again, that's going to be contained within that court area. It'll be an improvement.
All right. Okay, so you don't see any real increase in noise?
Nope.
Okay. And lighting you discussed, runoff you discussed, trees?
I have another question about the lighting. There's not going to be any lighting on Coddington. What about on Wheeler? Do we need lighting there?
No.
No. So the only lighting we're going to have is going to be in the parking lot where the trucks go.
And for this new lot here, there'll be three building-mounted lights. They'll also
okay.
be
down.
Okay. Lights. Yep.
All right.
All right, Mitch, what can you conclude on the variances from an engineering site design viewpoint?
From an engineering point, I think we've addressed the critical point of stormwater management to go with the impervious coverage.
Okay.
And with those improvements, which I think there'll be with this plan, I think we can grant the variances from an engineering standpoint.
All right, in your professional opinion as a civil engineer and the site engineer, was the site plan that you prepared and submitted to the board developed in accordance with all applicable professional and engineering standards?
Yes, it was.
Okay. I have no further questions.
Anything from the board?
I have a question.
Coddington
says proposed asphalt pavement. Are you guys doing that?
We are. We were requested between, well, basically we met with Mr. House early on at the pre-meeting, and for circulation he wanted to bring that out as far as we're showing it there. So we are doing it.
Is he a fire official?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. House.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, I guess it's traffic.
Yes, traffic. Mr. Chairman, we saw no negative comments in any of the reports on traffic. We do have Mr. Poliniak here from Dolan and Dean if the board had any questions, but we did submit a traffic impact assessment for the applicant on the proposed building addition that was originally dated August 10, 2015 and revised January 18, 2016. So unless the board has any specific questions.
Anything the board needs?
Well, just for the record, this is a county highway, right? County roadway, and it has been reviewed by Somerset County, and I didn't see any traffic-related objections or concerns in their report.
They had none.
Okay, whatever technical comments they have, you're going to meet.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, my final witness is Kevin O'Brien.
Solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth?
I do.
All right.
Okay, Kevin, no pressure, but this is the hardest testimony of the night, because you're going to explain to us how this is a good thing and not a bad thing.
I've been explained already by
No, no, no. They've explained as to how they're taking care of the small details.
What a setup, Kevin, huh? All right. We'll do it. We'll make. We'll get what
Mr.
you need.
Shepard, if it please you and if it please
you. Are you sworn in yet?
Yes.
Okay.
Let him talk about how he's still licensed in New Jersey.
I am still licensed. That youthful indiscretion never caught up with
me. Okay, we'll accept that.
If it please the board and the chair, you've had a lot of testimony this evening. The hour is weighing on. And rather than address all the points I've made in my 15-page outline, which I do to cover everything so that there's no question whatsoever that every single nit has been picked, every point has been made, I would be happy to go to a more conclusory statement and rely upon the testimony that has been given before me.
Well, I'd prefer you address the requirements.
Very well.
Me too.
There are a number of unique aspects to this application. You've heard the presentation by Mr. Bachnick that this is a product that the United States Agency for International Development, USAID, United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF, use throughout the world to treat malnourished, undernourished children, people who are victims of natural disasters, people who are refugees fleeing various unpleasantness going on throughout our world these days. And this is something that promotes the public good worldwide, not just here in Somerset or in New Jersey. The reason we're here tonight is for the expansion of that manufacturing plant to allow the peanut butter, the RUTF food, to be manufactured here. 19 new people will be employed at this location. That is 19 new families in this area. And these are families that rely upon the plant for their livelihood. And these are families that are going to spend their dollars here in Somerset, not in Brazil or Mexico or China. These are manufacturing jobs that will be here in New Jersey. There have been several previous approvals for this facility and this property. The Tabachnik facility received their approval back in 1997. And at the board, at the time, the board recognized that proximity to transportation and meeting the USDA requirements for cleanliness in the plant justified the relief that was requested back then. The board concluded that, quote, this is an appropriate use for the site. And also in that same resolution was, quote, the granting of the use variance, bulk variances, and site plan approval will not alter the general character of the neighborhood. In 2007, Anthony's Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling came before you received approval for a warehouse, as well as an office. That application was granted. As we all know what happened to the economy in 07, 08, and 09, that facility was never constructed. But the board did find in its approval, this is a good transitional use between residential and commercial uses which exist in the area, quote unquote. The site is particularly suited for the proposed use, quote unquote. No detrimental impact on the neighborhood in that traffic to and from the site will be minimal, also a quote. And last, the application can be done in a manner which will minimize any negative impact, also a quote from the resolution. This is very similar to those previous approvals. This is an expansion of the plant that you previously approved. And the Anthony's Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling was going to be a warehouse with an office. The application before you this evening is for a manufacturing facility and an office. And there is not an awful lot of difference that can be discerned from outside of the facility between that warehouse or a manufacturing facility. This is close to transportation networks, as the previous approval was, and extensive landscaping and stormwater management facilities are being provided as part of the site plan, as you've seen through Mitch's testimony and through the site plan that you have reviewed. The master plan in 2006 lists the following goals. First, encourage commercial and industrial development and talks about access to transportation networks. Talks about locating major employment and traffic drawing uses in areas where they will least impact residential neighborhoods. And also goes on to talk about providing adequate community facilities and those that serve the public good.
the March 2016 reexamination, adopted last month by the Planning Board, had this finding. The manufacturing sector, while declining at the statewide level, continues to maintain a high level of activity in Franklin due to the connectivity of major roadways, availability of land, availability of workers. And then it lists these goals. Maintain sufficient areas of light industrial zoning, and also talks about encouraging commercial and industrial development in areas with access to transportation networks. This application meets those goals of the 2006 and 2016 master plan by providing a manufacturing facility in an area that's proximate to the road transport network and manufacturing a product that has a positive impact throughout the world. The municipal land use law does have several passages that address this application. First is item A, to encourage municipal action to guide the appropriate use or development of all lands in this state to promote the general welfare. Item F, to encourage the appropriate and efficient expenditure of public funds by coordinating public development with land use policies. And G, to provide sufficient space in appropriate locations for a variety of reasons. M, to encourage coordination into the more efficient use of the land. This is in conformance with those passages from the municipal land use law by expanding this manufacturing facility. And while certainly not inherently beneficial under New Jersey state statutes, the impact of this product is felt around the world. In terms of negative impact, you've seen the site plan, you've seen the landscaping, you've seen the stormwater retention. I don't believe that there will be any negative impact from this site. As you can see behind me, there are not scores of neighbors who are upset about the operations of this site or about this application. So it must have, at the very least, a benign influence upon this neighborhood. So I don't believe that there is any negative impact, and in fact, I believe that there is a positive impact by improving that stormwater management. As you know, a use variance has to go through a three-step process for it to meet the burden of proof. The first is special reasons, and I believe that these are demonstrated by conforming to the municipal land use law in items A, F, G, and M, as I have recited. If you wish, I'll be happy to read them to you again, but in the interest of just moving along, I will not do that. This does provide manufacturing jobs, placing a manufacturing facility in a place that is particularly suited for it. In terms of the first prong of the negative criteria, this application can be reconciled with the master plan through the passages I've recited. It places a manufacturing facility near transportation networks, hires local people, provides employment, provides an economic boost to this area by putting families and people in the economic mix here and supporting other local businesses and manufacturing a product with a positive impact. And lastly, the negative criteria is met because there are no identifiable negative impacts of this facility upon the area or upon the public good. Any detriments are outweighed by the benefits, as you've heard in previous testimony. When refugees are are displaced by the turmoil of war, or people are in a natural disaster that does not allow them to access food on a regular basis or a sustainable basis, this product is one that has saved lives for several years and is one that is recognized by the United States government and by the United Nations as essential to help those people in their time of need. This will have a positive impact upon the world as a whole. That's something you really don't get to say very much before a Zoning Board of Adjustment. I would conclude that this application can be granted without substantial detriment to the public good and without substantial impairment to the zone plan and zoning ordinance. And while not as brief as I want it to be, I hope that caught all the major points for you, and I welcome any questions.
How close are other commercial and industrial uses to this particular site?
The gas station is pretty proximate to it, immediately to the west. And the M2 zone, which this is a very good example of, but in the R10, is both to the west of us and to the east of us with similar industrial properties. So we're sort of, when you look at the first page of the site plan and you see the zoning map, we're just a property away from M2 to the west and one block away from M2 to the east. And the fact that this has been an industrial site for some years, the residences behind us are fairly spread out and separated from this location. So they are nearby. They're not exactly in a row because the next block, 2, is to the east, is residential, but that's uninterrupted residential on that block, so the manufacturing jumps.
I have a question for our attorney.
Yeah.
Can we, in our resolution, say that we're going to grant them the right to manufacture this particular product? Because a lot of what he's saying relates to the fact that they're making a product, and I would agree that's good. It's got a beneficial use. Can we limit it that way? Is there some way we can? I guess my concern would be that they would, could they turn this place into a tallow works if we give them? Is there some way we can limit what they do?
Well,
to what they do.
The best way to do that is when you make your decision and you put your findings of fact and conclusions out there, you would want to link the granting, if that's the way you're leaning, to much of the testimony which concerns this very product. That would be the best way to do it, and I would do my best to write the resolution accordingly. But keep in mind that while somebody may have to come in again to modify it, you are essentially giving them a manufacturing business
right
there. So,
if I might offer a suggestion, perhaps yes, peanut butter is what's driving the bus. Okay.
Yeah.
Who knows? In the future, it may be peanut butter and other substantially related food products serving the same purpose. Something like that would probably be appropriate because those other food products, although not peanut butter. And I can't anticipate, I don't know what I did yesterday, I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, as long as they're related to the grant of the use variance, if that's where the board is leaning. So I think Mr. Bradshaw might be in a position to craft a resolution in that order, if that's where the board is going.
I get it.
Well, when you were asked about other commercial development, you mentioned the gas station. Well, next to that's an office building, and next to that's going to be a retail center. So this is not a facility that's in isolation in any way, shape, or form. I don't have a concern about other products other than the fact that part of the testimony about the manufacturing of the peanut butter described how the process would probably ensure that there was no odor or anything like that, which we can't talk about with other products because we don't know if that's what they're going to be. I don't know. It sounded to me, maybe I'm mistaking it from the testimony, that this is being set up really for peanut butter, and there are certain elements in the manufacture of it that don't lend themselves to mixing with other products. So I wasn't really concerned about that part of it, but I can see that there might be. So I sort of gleaned from this testimony that you're setting up a new facility that's pretty specific to peanut butter, that it doesn't lend itself to being, the manufacturing of it doesn't lend itself to being shared with other products.
That's accurate. That's accurate. Because it's peanut butter, you can't have water. And the soup business is 90% water. So they have to be separated. You can't have water in.
So if you were doing other products, they would most likely go to the other part of the facility, which is already approved to that, for that first place.
Right. I don't just make soup on the other side. I also make things like macaroni and cheese. I make fruit toppers. So, and I'm actually doing a line of like emulsified foods that I'll be introducing to hospitals relatively soon. But that I make on the soup side. I can't go on the peanut butter side. I can't have water.
I would, Mr. Chairman, I would.
I have the confidence that Mr. Bradshaw can write.
Again, I would continue my suggestion that I don't know what's going to happen 10 years from now, as long as it serves the similar type use, if that's where the board is going.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, I think we all, assuming the board approves this, we would hope that Tabashnik is at this site forever. But you never know. 10 years from now, you might expand, and you might have to move to a larger facility. And if some other manufacturer comes in here, they'd have to get another use variance if they're doing something completely different. So I think, with that in mind, I'm sure Pat can write some wording based on the testimony that's been provided to appropriately tie it to the testimony that's been provided.
That's always the case. If there's a change of use, obviously, if it's not substantially similar to the use
somebody
approved.
Somebody was going to come in and do peanut butter again, it wouldn't need a use variance. But if it's something completely different, then it would. And again, I'm sure
like
Pat
jelly. Can, no.
Mm-hmm. No, that would, actually it could, it just have to be on the other side, Frank.
Yeah.
I will be like virtually the only peanut butter manufacturer in the tri-state area. There's very big peanut butter manufacturers, and the big guys who are Con Ed, Skippy, and I think Hormel is the other one. Is it Hormel?
Hormel. All right, we're good.
Jason. They don't do any contract packaging, so the opportunities for peanut butter, besides my RUTF, are huge. If I ever wanted to move the RUTF somewhere else, I would still be able to do peanut butter. I could do private label peanut butter. I can do school lunch peanut butter. I mean, in all honesty, probably everybody in this room would probably eat peanut butter.
Unless you're allergic.
Yeah. Unless you're allergic.
Yeah.
Right. I hope that allays your concerns.
Yep.
Okay. Any other questions for planning?
I have a question. You didn't describe the surrounding land uses. Is there a house to the west?
Yes, there is a house to the west toward Shirley.
Okay. And next to that is...
That's a gas station.
No, isn't there an Elks Club or something there?
In the back, I think.
It's in the back.
Okay.
Set back.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. And across, what's across the street?
From Hamilton. Hamilton across the street appears to be vacant.
Okay.
A lot of growth there. There's a driveway that isn't paved. It doesn't seem to go anywhere. That's what my understanding.
It's an unimproved street.
Oh, it is.
Okay. And I think there's some wetland, so it's not developed.
Okay.
But isn't there? There's an approval back in there.
Right next to it, there is. Yeah, that's what's his name? The flower shop.
Yes.
Right.
The flower shop has an approval there from like 8-9 years ago.
I think that's down the road more.
That's by Veronica.
Yeah, that's by Veronica.
Courtyard where the loading will be,
mm-hmm.
directly across the street is not.
The flower shop's on Veronica.
Yeah.
Across the street's undeveloped.
Across the street is vacant, wooded, unimproved.
All right, thank you.
Anything else? Okay, we'll make the token open to the public. If anyone wants to make a comment, make a note that there appears to be no general public present. All applicant-related witnesses or attendees, so we'll close.
Fine job. That was a really good
go to it.
Very briefly, Mr. Chairman, I'm proud to represent the Tabachniks in this application because I think it's a real good application. I think we've successfully submitted proof sufficient for you to grant the use variance and the other variances that have been presented. And the site plan itself appears to be sufficient for your approval. So we would respectfully suggest that on the basis of all the evidence and the documentation and the plans and the testimony that this application in its entirety deserves approval, subject to the conditions that we've testified to on the record, the compliance with the staff reports where appropriate, and your normal standard conditions, getting all the outside agency approvals. So I'm very pleased that, as the applicant's attorney, to have presented this application. I think it is worthy of the board's consideration and approval.
Okay, anything from the board, discussion or motion?
Well, I'll make a motion and then we'll kind of have some discussion, I think. I move that we grant Tabachnik Fine Foods, Inc. The variances, including the use variance required to for them to construct the peanut butter manufacturing facility at 1230 Hamilton Avenue, Somerset, Block 92, lots 5 through 48, subject to the following: the building when constructed, and the landscaping will be in accordance with the designs and the examples shown in the documents disclosed in today's hearing, and that the building will be painted a beige color, and when it is painted, both the old portion of the building and the new portion of the building will be painted at the same time so as to create a unitary look.
Is there a second?
Wait, that's
second.
It? That's all you're...
That's all I have, really.
Wait a second.
Because everything else...
All right, I just... I'm used to more from you. To work with staff regarding the curbing and the trees?
Yes, and that they will work with staff regarding the curbing and the trees on Coddington and Wheeler.
Okay, and you want me to put sufficient language in the resolution, correct?
Right, but I was going to talk about that, I thought, as to when we give our vote. I thought that that
you
was
can talk about
that.
It, but I also want you to put it in as a condition.
Okay, and that
just
the,
you can super
yeah the quick. Reason that we see this as a positive use is because the product that's going to be made is one that's needed to deal with issues of hunger and famine in other countries, and it is a product that will not create a lot of either odor or other disturbance in the immediate neighborhood, and will serve as a good light manufacturing use in accordance with the zone plan.
Now we need a second.
Second.
There we go.
Any discussion, questions, comments?
Now, the only thing that I would like to say is that I'm going to vote in favor of it, and the reason I'm going to vote in favor of it is because of the testimony that we've heard about the product that's going to be made there and the purpose that product will be put to, that it's got a humanitarian value and will also be a positive effect on employment within Princeton Township.
Franklin.
How about Franklin?
Yeah, Franklin, sorry. I'm a little bit, you know.
We all understand that. Yeah. That's your Princeton mailing.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
All righty. Mr. Butterbid.
Four.
Mr. Johnson. Oh, sorry, wrong person. Mr. Rich.
Four.
Mr. Shepard.
Four.
Mr. Rosenthal.
Yes.
Mr. Reese.
Yes.
Mr. Begala.
Yes. I'd
Chairman
like
Tom.
To.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
I was going to say something. I do agree that it's particularly suited for this site due to its adjacency to the existing manufacturing facility, and I like the design. It's very self-contained. All of the loading docks and busy stuff is in the center of the site, and it doesn't, it least impacts the surrounding residences. Yes.
Chairman Thomas.
I vote yes also, and I agree with a lot of Cheryl's comments about the design and the way it eliminates a lot of the effects on any of the neighborhoods behind it. Anyway, good luck with it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now we'll entertain a motion.
We are meeting in 2 weeks, just so everybody knows. There is a meeting.
Now, to adjourn the meeting. All right, meeting.